Welcome to National Arts. I'm Mike Baker. African American artists began traveling to Paris to study the French tradition in the visual arts as early as the 1830s. These sojourns to Paris continued throughout the 20th century until they became a tradition interrupted only by two world wars. Explorations in the City of Light, African American Artists in Paris, 1945 to 1965, at the Studio Museum in Harlem, takes a look at seven prominent African American artists and the role they played in the confluence of two continents. The determination of African American artists to fulfill their dreams is part of what this exhibition is about, isn't it?
Yes, absolutely. Artists have been engaged with a process of having their ideas realized and their art recognized. And I think that African American artists are as much a part of that as any in the world. And I think that our institution is devoted to seeing some aspect of that realized so that their works may be seen and may be written about and may be critically assessed and known, so that those ideas can be seen in ways that are as concrete as they can be within the context of the visual arts. And that's what our mission is in terms of exposure of those ideas.
African American artists for the post-World War II period and the experiences they had, the exemplary works they created, it's relatively unexamined, with the exception perhaps of this exhibit and a few others.
Yeah, it's one of the challenges that the museum has taken on has been to develop an art historical record that really is an inclusive one, that looks at various periods and various artists that have not been included in the record. And this exhibition certainly has afforded us the opportunity to examine seven artists and their very specific encounters, the development of their work, so that that might be seen. One of the unique and wonderful opportunities that the Studio Museum offers as a place in which exhibitions are mounted and scholarship is conducted, because that's a way for us to inform not only the field, but those people who are interested in art on a global basis now. Certainly we have our local audience, we have our national audience, and we have an international audience. And we think that those audiences deserve to have excellent scholarship that has been produced, like the catalog that is for this show, for which Valerie Mercer, the curator of the exhibition, has written, as well as other scholars and art historians who can actually place this work in a context which would be understood and is seen as a parallel to various other art histories, and certainly a parallel to periods that have been examined by other institutions and for other artists.
The show so much is about these artists, their quest for modernism and their desire as young American artists after World War II to learn a great deal more about European modernism, more than one could actually get in the schools here. A lot of American art institutions still tended to emphasize French Impressionism. I mean, that was sort of their idea of modernism still in the mid-1940s. But artists knew that there was a lot more going on, they wanted to learn more about it. And again, they were still being taught, as Americans had been in the 19th century, that really be successful as an artist, one needed that Paris experience on the resume to show that you had really absorbed the French tradition, because that was still the American model. Particularly, they knew of the story of Henry Asala Tanner, who pretty much was the role model for a lot of African American artists. He had gone to Paris in the 1890s and had quite a good success there and spent the rest of his life there, was honored by the French and was a great painter. So they knew that, as well, that there were writers, African American writers there, and that the French tended to welcome them and treat them with respect, mainly because, they were artists and creative people, and France had that great tradition of always respecting creative people. And also, I wanted artists who were very diverse in styles. also to show that African-American artists are not a monolithic group of artists. Often there are people who still think that, you know, they have the same interests, the same artistic concerns, and of course they don't.
In 1923, Paris was really the center of the Western art world. And it was also the place where the black artist could be free. It was a wonderful thing to be free artistically, and that's where artists were going, like Henry O. Tanner.
The adulation of African art in Paris had a profound influence on you, didn't it?
Oh, very definitely. When I arrived, well, it was a General Education Board fellowship to study at the Academy Julia. And at that time, the museums and the galleries were showing African masks, sculpture, African art, and textiles. And I made many sketches and went back to my studio. And it was there that I did my creative work and did a study, which is the painting quite well known today, Les Fétiches. That was in 1938. It was of from the sketches of the masks, and I worked in oil on canvas and did that painting.
Well, it seems like you didn't employ the impressionistic formlessness. You gave more life and more form, almost a post-impressionistic aura about your work.
Well, that's so true. You noticed that in the paintings. So that it was a great experience. And then I won a wonderful fellowship from Howard University to visit 11 countries in Africa. And it was very much like Haiti. As a matter of fact, I think I've done my best work in my Haiti studio, because Haiti has never lost her ties with Mother Africa. I feel there these similar feelings to what happened to me in going to those 11 countries and studying the masks and the art of the people and meeting with the artists. It was a very rich, rich experience.
Your Haitian works are striking.
There's very definitely more hard edge, very much going back to textile design. And working around those marketplaces and at the voodoo rituals and making studies of the quite obvious in a more, we might say, stylism handling and more cubism in those paintings. And then the other one in the show of the Veve, which gave me a wonderful opportunity to use mixed media and much more color. So that when you compare the two sources, there's a very, very definite difference in my feeling.
Your mother and child has a certain realism.
That was an interesting subject. I remember doing that of my laundry lady and her baby, who posed for me. And then I introduced, as you can see, something of a modern composition.
Untitled has an almost Cézanne look to it.
That particular one that's in the show, Panorama, was one of my favorite works. It has been mentioned that I must have been influenced by Cézanne. I might say that I really didn't know too much about Cézanne, but there is a feeling, there's no question about it, of how I introduced the Impressionism in those works, Saint-Tropez and Sparacedis, those beautiful olive trees, the beauty of the countryside. It was a great experience, very different from Paris, to paint those landscapes with the red, orange-roofed houses was a great experience for color. I sort of made a circle and sort of coming back with much vigor and color, as you note in the show, what Africa did. and the diaspora, which really has been my inspiration, major inspiration.
We're surrounded by the work of Buford Delaney, who went to Paris in 1953 after having exhibited quite a bit in New York. But he had, like many artists, wanted to go to Paris. So he arrives there in 1953. And the early paintings that we have in the show, done soon after he arrives in Paris, show him looking at Chartres Cathedral, the stained glass windows. And it's sort of done in a kind of abstract way that shows him basically studying the color and the effects of light on the beautiful colored stones that comprise the stained glass. And then there is a little kind of like mystical type landscape that was kind of a surprise to me, the Austrian landscape that we have from, I believe it's from 1955. But then you see in the exhibition portraiture as well as the type of abstract painting that Buford began to do in Paris around the 60s, I believe. He painted the portraits of friends, a lot of whom were creative people, like the James Baldwin, who was a very close friend, and he greatly admired Marian Anderson. He did love music, and he loved, I think, the kind of beautiful voice she had.
Herbie, born in Pittsburgh, but grew up in Harlem, That was a very important influence in your life, wasn't it?
Oh, definitely it was. It prepared me to see other things. Harlem sent me to Paris, because Harlem was like Paris then, especially then.
You talk a lot about the city as having almost an aura or a perfume about it. It sounds almost as if you had a romance with the city early on.
I did. I fell for that city as soon as I saw it. Something in the air. And it was very interesting because it was new. But it was, I just can't claim that I'm the only one who felt that way. Many years ago when I returned as a civilian, I'll tell you a bit later, this year would make the 50th anniversary.
Oh, how marvelous.
That the African Americans and white Americans painters were together in Paris together. We never had any interracial incident from no one I know in Paris, white and black. And I point this out for a fact, I mean for a reason, to say that this can happen and happen in Paris.
While you didn't have to endure emotional hardships when you returned to Paris after the war, there were certainly physical hardships
yes,
to endure, weren't there?
Before I said I was going back to Paris, I was going to NYU, and I said I have to go back to Paris to school to study art more. And I do recall that we were cautioned by the State Department not to go because they said it's very hard living there because everything was rationed. You had to stand in line for your bread, butter, and all this. The lights would go out in the afternoon, late afternoon. You were without lights for a while. I remember I have pictures of standing in the bread line for the bread was rationed and all like that. But with all that, it was great.
Embracing the European styles meant commercial success. You were part of a pack of young rebels where you could be a little more creative and explore the subconscious, and that movement more or less sums that up.
Yes. Yeah, it was a great period for all of us, yeah.
You took the art world in a different direction.
In a different direction, yeah. Yes.
One of the first pieces where you developed your figurative style, your subconscious style, was the claw.
Mm-hmm.
People have tried to give it a variety of different political overtones, haven't they?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
But you prefer to allow people to see in your works what they want to see.
Oh, definitely, because I didn't consciously do it for a political reason. But it was in my subconscious, so that was my truth. I never thought of that. Yes. And I look at it today and I said, it's fantastic, you know, that I, like it's not my painting anymore, you know? I said, hey. It might have something to do with the situation there, political situation, but I didn't calculatedly do it that way. But that's what art, if it's art, that's already there, it was already done.
We see in some of your later works that clearly their African influence is present.
Oh, definitely, that has to be there. There's all different influences. You can't just run away. I mean, if you're an artist, you express yourself according to not what you lived as biologically, but how you lived, what you've seen, the experiences you've had. So that's a definite experience, being a black black American, also being a human being. I mean, I had white friends too, they're in it too. But that strong point of blackness, I think, is shown. And I didn't calculate some of paint a black person. It's part of me, it's my life. And I think that's what art is about. But other experiences, other people I live, they're in it too.
Amid the crowd,
has
been a very popular favorite of many people.
Oh yes, at PS1 in Long Island. This young, he was a painter, a student painter, but he was working there as a sort of a guide. And he said, everybody loves that painting.
Friendship.
Yes.
This does, in a way, represent the balance that you have struck between abstraction and figuration.
Yes, yes, I really feel
which
that.
Which is a very tenuous precipice to yes. dangle on at times,
yes,
isn't
yes.
it?
You know, if I try too hard, too, in a painting, too, it doesn't flow freely. And I guess I was in a very good, the right recipe has to happen. You can't make it so. And I think it worked out well.
The depth of soul in these pieces is clearly evident.
You make me cry. Yeah, because I feel you in what you're saying. Well, I've got a lot of love in life.
Some internal struggle, too.
It's internal. If I paint, it's not always my hand. It's my mother's hand and me, my father's hand.
Well, Barbara Chase Reboud is well known as an artist as well as a poet and novelist. She originally came from Philadelphia and went to Paris kind of on a break, a little vacation, and never left. It was really exciting for me to work on Barbara's work done prior to, you know, the 70s and all, which was work I did know a bit about. But seeing her really early work from the 50s and the 60s was quite a surprise to me. It was just so incredibly different. There are works we have in the show, one called Last Supper. It's from 1958 and shows her looking at African art. So the work is comprised of these African masks, but they're almost given life. Barbara had arrived in Paris in 1961, and at that point she was exposed to the work of an artist hardly known here. Her name was Germaine Richier. She was an important sculptor in Paris. She had been part of Giacometti's circle, and you could see in works in the show, particularly like Adam and Eve, that you could see his influence in that work. One of my favorite pieces in the show is a plant woman. You look at her and you just feel so sorry for her. You could see that she is this kind of hybrid, which was also one of the types of imagery that surrealists love to use. And then there are these wonderful bone sculptures in the show. There are three of them, and what Barbara's done is kind of give them a sort of three-dimensionality and express them sort of in her own particular way. Close by, you see some of Barbara's contemporary work called Untitled Pushkin. So it also refers to the great Russian poet. What I did by having these two contemporary works of Barbara's, I had wanted people to see with the four living artists who are in the show, I wanted them to see where they were at, you know, this point in their career and how they continue to develop and how they sustain their commitment to their art even up to today.
You studied at the Art Institute in Chicago.
Yeah.
That was a rather structured environment, wasn't it?
Really, it was like the Beaux-Arts in Paris, very structured. You couldn't paint before you drew. You couldn't have figure painting before you had still life painting and drawing. And that's what, you know, that's it's different now. But in those days, yes.
Of course, one of the big influences in the 40s was Impressionism.
In Chicago, really. There's a school, I didn't even know it at the time, but now, away from us, too close to it. The Impressionist School of America is more or less when you talk about Chicago, right? They taught that. And my instructor was a real French Impressionist. He was Russian-born, named Louis Rittman, but he was not studied on the Monet, but he was in Giverny, must have been around the turn of the century.
You went to Paris in 1952 to experience, as you say, the city's romantic legend.
I also went because I could go. And why not, right? I'm on the GI Bill in the Chicago Art Institute. And to my surprise, I was going on Saturdays and nights, three nights a week. So I wasn't really using it up as much as I thought. You had 4 years, so I had like a year left. And then all of a sudden I thought, I met someone and said, hey, you could live in Paris, the opposite now, you could live in Paris on the GI Bill by itself.
Is it true that you went to Paris to make a transition from, say, representational art to, say, abstract art, or did it just coincide with that kind of transition in your life?
No, I went there and I was very much a representational artist in France, and I changed. Really, I had a show in the big Salon d'Automne, 1952, and in that show, everybody, including Matisse and Picasso, they put them in there as a token, but big paintings, they just alone. And then I was walking down one of the big corridors, and there was this de Staël. And when I looked at the Nicolas de Staël, just big gestures and this sort of plastic type of way of painting, and almost really like plastic, literally. It was just something I had never seen. I didn't even know it was a football player. It, to me, it's abstract painting. So there becomes between the two. When I saw that the surface is more interesting than the subject to me, then I began to get, wait a moment, what is the truth in painting? And so then this, so one painting here we call The City is when I first was my transitional period. You could smell the figure in some of that period. That one's called The City, but even after that, when I thought they were abstract, I could see the figures. You can smell the figure and you can smell the landscape and figures in there.
If you watch your art and how it's evolved, you could see how it was natural that eventually the strokes would get broader, that there would be more texture in the strokes.
Well, now also the strokes got to be unbelievable. You know, the push broom comes in there, and you got a push broom. Good artist, a bad artist, you can push the paint to the other side, right? It's immediate. The push will give you a different gesture than the wrist.
You were one of the first to venture beyond the frame.
Yeah, that's right. The shape painting you see in here, which was shown in the Brada Gallery in 56, I think, at the Christmas show. And that, some people, it's often been said that that's generally considered the first shape painting.
Larry Potter went to Paris for the first time, actually, in 1956, after he had studied at Cooper Union. And he looks at the work of certain geometric abstractions like Maurice Esteve and Serge Polyakov. And you can see there are examples in the show that show his absorption of their particular treatment of form from Serge Polyakov. He learns how to work with these beautiful transparent layers of planes of color that kind of have a geometric type form. And from Maurice Esteve, I think what comes out very strongly in him is this basic tendency to be a very strong colorist, you know. But then in the last few works in the show, you see Larry come into his own. And these works date from just a few years prior to his death in 66. He died actually quite young. A lot of us didn't know his work until probably about 1991, when there was a show at June Kelly, where she had started to show his work. And there was quite a lot of interest aroused as a result of that show. And I think the important thing was that critics who saw the show wrote about how fresh and contemporary his work looked, that it was hard for some of them to believe that, you know, it had actually been done in the 60s. Harold Cousins went to Paris in 1949 on the GI Bill. Harold learned how to weld from the American artist Shinkichi Tajiri, who eventually becomes as well an important artist, but spends the rest of his life in Europe. But they were very good friends, and Tajiri was a sculptor who mainly welded. So you could see from work in the exhibition that that is Harold's primary approach to metal sculpture. There are beautiful examples of Harold welding broad sheets of metal to create beautiful planes, some of which you'll see like in El Matador. And you also see some wonderful examples of one of Gonzalez's important techniques, which was what he called drawing in space, where the artist uses the metal rod so that it creates the effect of drawing in space. And there are a few examples of that in Bird Torso, as well as this wonderful piece called King of the Musicians, which I think also shows that Harold had a kind of a sense of humor too.
The fact that this venue is going to tour will mean a great deal. Mm-hmm. And I would think that it would be almost impossible without the kind of funding that you're getting from Philip Morris.
Oh, that's very true. I mean, that was one of the wonderful thing about it was that Philip Morris was so supportive about the show. And right from the start, when we presented the project to them, they basically loved the work and thought it was a really exciting project. And you're absolutely right. I mean, we could only probably could probably open here and close if it wasn't for that kind of support.
This exhibit helps us to focus on the role that African-American artists play in our American art history.
Yes, absolutely. And we think that, again, is an essential role that the museum has taken on. We see that it represents a real gap in the art historical canon that exists now, and we feel that it is an important gap to fill, and we welcome other institutions, other scholars to tackle these areas, because we do think that if art history is to be looked at in a truly representative way, we want to make sure that it is an inclusive art history.
We hope you enjoyed seeing the works of these prominent American artists. There's a full schedule of interpretive programs here at the museum. We encourage you to partake in them. Until next time, remember, art was meant to be appreciated, so you be a part of it.